right. Good morning, everyone. It's the 84th Coffee with the Commissioner. It's Wednesday morning, 6:30 a.m. And wow, we have a lot to talk about. There's been so much news in the weather lately. So we have Eric Gilmore to talk about public safety. Obviously, we have Wes Moreno here this morning to give us an update on county business and all the cool stuff that's happening. And then we have a very special guest this morning. We have Dr. Rick Harper, who is the former director of the UWF Haas Center. He's an economist. And now he is the economic advisor to Triumph Gulf Coast. So we're going to talk all about economic development. And really, he gave an interesting, very interesting, in-depth PowerPoint at a recent luncheon that I attended. And I just thought it was full of great information that folks would be interested in. So he's graciously agreed to join us early this morning. And we're going to go through his PowerPoint and some interesting slides. And we're going to talk about, you know, the national economy a little bit, because it all, you know, impacts us eventually. Then we're going to talk about the regional economy. And then we're going to talk about Pensacola and Escambia County. And there's some really fantastic, excellent news that we're going to talk about to report that really doesn't get a lot of coverage. So I really look forward to that discussion as well. So it's going to be a great hour. We've got a lot to talk about. So again, I appreciate everyone being here. So what we typically do is we start out with an update on county business. So Wes, what's going on in the county?
There's a lot of good things going on in the county, Commissioner. So first and foremost, we have a balanced budget. It'd be about $700 million, but it is balanced. We are working on our budget books now. Y'all should be seeing that information real up fairly soon in the next couple of weeks. Monumental task. We met with every department, every director, every deputy director. We went line by line comparison to the last 2 to 3 years and what the needs are as we move forward. So I think we're in a good position there with the budget. And so I'm looking forward to getting through the hearings, getting that behind us so we can get on back to regular business, I guess you could say. But then, you know, of course, you mentioned it. I won't say too much about it because we got Eric here, but we had the weather that turned into a big deal for us last week. And so I just want to say how much I appreciate all of our partners, from law enforcement to, you know, homeless providers, ECAT, EMS, fire. Certainly can't forget Public Works. They were all out in the middle of the storm, in the middle of the night. Phones were ringing all night long, and it came together very well. And we did what we do. You know, we had a hurricane exercise not too long ago, and the guy came in. He kept saying, "What would you do of this? What would you do of that? What would you do of this?" So I'm like, "We're going to handle it. That's what we do."
That's right.
We've been at this a long time, and so it really orchestrated well. I mean, we moved the folks out of Forest Creek fairly quickly. You had the homeless center there. We moved those folks as well. Our plan for to have utilize ECAT buses worked flawlessly. And so, I'll let Eric speak a little more in depth to that. As far as just things throughout the county, animal shelter they're struggling a little bit at the moment from vacancies, but they're doing a great job. John Robinson and the company are doing a great job. Engineering is always knocking it out of the park, doing a great job. We met with Department of Economic Development yesterday, DEO, and Economic Opportunity, rather. And so, you know, we submitted our grant applications for a number of projects. So we had a review of those applications yesterday, did some site visits yesterday. And so we owe them some information back probably today or tomorrow. And hopefully we'll hear an announcement before too much longer than the next month or two about what, if any, grant dollars we may bring into Escambia County. Homeless is a big thing. We had a meeting on that yesterday and sat down with Allison Patton with the city and Shannon Smiley and Travis and myself and Liz Kissel. And we just went through all the maps around Midtown, all the maps. Properties that might be available, and then also talked about the continuum of care and the technical assistance portion of that. And so we're excited about some things that may be able to come in and help us modify our continuum of care, make some improvements there that need to be made. And our goal is to, or my goal anyway, is to bring our homeless providers together and communicate. They're kind of siloed up right now, if you will. So mm-hmm. We want to bring them together, share information, share ideas, share funding opportunities, and see if we can't move the needle with the homeless situation a little bit here in Pensacola. We're moving into July 4th weekend. It'll be a big weekend for us on Pensacola Beach, as always, and just the community in general. And then we move into Blues on the Beach after that, and it'll be another huge weekend. So things are hopping everywhere throughout the county. Public safety is doing a fantastic job. We're filling vacancies. We had over 400 vacancies this time last year. Right now we have about 300 vacancies. So we have moved the needle there, and we're continuing to move the needle. We're continuing to see a lot of job applications come in for the various vacancies that we do have, which is encouraging. Public Works is actually almost staffed, fully staffed back up. So the changes and modifications that we made to the pay rates there, and I think helping them to achieve their commercial driver's license through Pensacola State College has been a game changer for us. So we put about 12 to 13 folks through that program, and we have about 5 to 7 more ready to go through the program. And it's really let us move the needle in our vacancies there at Public Works, which is great because this time of year is a super, super busy time and for our Public Works folks out there. But
hey, Wes, let me ask you a question, kind of going backwards a little. And that is a great program, training the CDL drivers, because I know that's a real hole in the market. There's great demand for it, and there's a limited number of people willing to do it. So the fact that we're going to help them get the training, and that's 100% paid for, right? They don't have to pay it back as long as they come to work. Was it 2 years they have to work for?
Two years.
Yeah, what a great deal. So if you don't want to work in an office, you don't want to really do a standard job, just come here straight out of high school, right? What do you have to have? A high school diploma, right?
High school diploma and a clean background.
And what do those guys make once they get the CDL and they have a few years under their belt?
They'll come in once they achieve their CDL, they'll make $18.81 an hour.
Okay. And within a couple of years, you know that. And is there overtime opportunities? I mean,
there are some overtime opportunities, especially like this past weekend. There was plenty of overtime opportunities.
I bet there was, yeah.
But so it's $18.81 an hour. You get 96 hours of annual leave, 96 hours of sick leave, insurance, retirement.
Nice benefits package. It really is. I can tell you, the benefits package that we offer here in Escambia County is incredible, particularly that health insurance. I mean, health insurance is such an incredibly expensive thing to a private employee out in town, unless you're with one of the big hospitals or Navy Federal or out at the base. I mean, you know, what we offer is better than a lot of that. I mean, it really is a fantastic benefit. We don't get credit for that when it comes to union bargaining time, but
No, we don't. It's always a discussion, but we've done well. You get 14 paid holidays a year.
That's amazing. Juneteenth. So Juneteenth, we were offered, I mean, the county was offered Juneteenth. Most private employers were not. I mean, I was out at work. I worked that day. So anyway, yeah. So 14 paid holidays, all that. It sounds like a commercial, but we still have 300 openings. So we've got a lot of jobs.
We are a good organization to work for. Absolutely a great organization.
So the budget, $700 million. Explain to the people who are going to watch this, how much of that comes from the local property tax roll, and did the property tax roll, a lot of us were concerned it was going to go down a little this year. How did that hold up? It apparently has held up pretty well.
It increased about 10.5% to 11%.
That's amazing. That's incredible.
Big up to us. FRS put the hammer on us a little bit. Medicaid put the hammer on us a little bit. We had some other folks that are coming and asking for some funding assistance, and we'll have to work through some of that. I'll say this, the other thing, I'm trying to keep things out of the general fund, of course.
Yes.
And so the sheriff had put in for an appropriation from the state for these fentanyl testing kits. Really helps the deputies and the canine units be more safe out there handling the stuff they handle. And so we had an opioid abatement funding committee meeting yesterday, and that was a qualifying expense. And so he was, rather than having to come to us or come to the board, which this action will still come through the board, but he was able to apply through that committee because we have about $2.5 million sitting there that has come in, and we will continue to get more money as the years go by. But it was a qualifying expense. It kept it out of the general fund and kind of kept a lot of discussion down, if you will. And so you'll see that on the agenda on the 18th to ratify that.
Now that's an interesting topic because a lot of folks have asked about that. On the one side, you've got the Narcan, which helps people when they've already overdosed. On the other side, a lot of people, a lot of folks have said to me they don't support test strips because they go, well, you're enabling them to continue to do drugs. I look at it completely differently. I'm enabling people to save their own life. Yeah, I mean, if you...
Right. Well, these are actually kits that the deputies use on scene.
All right. These are not the ones that... These are not the ones that are... They're not the ones distributed to, I'm sorry, I'm talking over
you. No, you're good. Go ahead.
No, these aren't the ones that you distribute to the citizens who can test them.
No. Okay. This is not those, no.
Okay, good.
These are actual test kits to be used by the deputies. Helps them know what they're dealing with, helps them stay a little safer. And also your canine units too. They walk in and there's powder residue everywhere on the table or the floor or something. So it helps them know a little more quickly and accurately what substance it is that they're dealing with, especially fentanyl.
That's dangerous. That's dangerous stuff. Hey, on that topic, I know that we are still in negotiations with OLF-8. What's the status of that after this meeting? Is D.R. Horton, we might break a little news here, but is D.R. Horton still in the game?
They are still in the game. So we met last week and we sat around the table. It was myself, Allison Rogers, Joy Blackman, Chris Phil, I mean, all the players, Drew Homer, Horace, John Fisher, we were all in there with D.R. Horton. And it was a good meeting. It was just an open communication. They had some questions about entitlements, of course, as we move forward. Mm-hmm. And they had connection questions about how permits going on the 9 mile road and maybe some zoning questions and those sorts of things and how they laid out the newest concept, which does hold back 241 acres that we would keep.
Okay.
I think as the board had directed. And so it does include all of that. And they're going to take all of those answers and all of those concepts and go back and provide us a counter offer. Could be within the next week, maybe 2 weeks, but they seem fairly positive when they left. And we felt like the meeting was a good meeting, felt like it went very well. And we'll just need to see what the counteroffer really looks like.
Did the other entity from local, the other local entity, did they put an offer in yet?
No.
Nothing else?
Okay. The only offer we have on the table is the DR/Sterling
offer. Okay. All right. I keep thinking that you're probably going to get another one, but okay.
I keep hearing that. I've emailed some information out, but I haven't seen anything yet.
We'll see what happens with that. The final thing on the OLF-8 is we are going to hold back that 250 acres for job creation. So that's going to take a while for us to really put into play. But next March, we're going to break a little news here on this too. Next March, apparently we are going to, the Escambia County Sheriff's Office here locally is going to host the National Canine Challenge for their canine units all around the country. But they need giant areas of fields where they can set up, put stuff out there for the various canines to go hunt and find it. And so I was speaking with some folks and Wes, I want to go ahead and make sure that we set aside 10 to 15 acres for that, because I think that'll be a great event. It's next March and I don't think we're going to have anything going on the commerce section by then. So is that something that the staff could help us put together so the sheriff's office could set up the courses out there?
Yeah, absolutely. We can always help facilitate those kinds of things.
Yeah, I think that'll be a big deal. And Escambia County Sheriff's Office hosting that, all these agencies from around the Southeast and the country bringing the best of their canines here, that's going to be a big deal. But it's March of next year. But I just wanted to put a plug in for that and make sure we set aside, 10, 15 acres for them to set up their courses. That's going to be really cool. Looking forward to that. So without further ado, Eric, as we were talking about, Wes, did you have anything else from the county?
I believe I've said enough.
Well, before we started the call, Eric and I were just kind of talking about just how quiet things have been. It's just been so lackadaisical around here. Nothing, absolutely. No action, nothing going on.
It's going to be real quiet next week. I guess people going to fact. So.
Oh, yeah. Well, hopefully. But Eric, I'll tell you, man, I want to put something, I'm going to try something I haven't done before, but I'm going to try and use some technology here and share my screen. Hopefully I don't fall on my face, but yeah, here it is. You sent us some interesting stuff from Iowa State University. Let's see if I can find it here. Here we go. You sent us an email. I'm going to put this up. And this was Sunday morning that you sent us this email. And when you go to it and you click the link, it takes you to an Iowa State website, which gives a lot of information. Can you see that on the screen, Eric?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So you're familiar with what this is. So anyhow, tell us about when you received this and number one, thank you for sharing that with the board and sending it out as an email, because I put it on my blog and the thing just got crushed and smashed with hits because it had interesting information. So when did you get this, and tell me about how they put this together?
So what it is a survey team comes out, and like Mobile Weather and those national meteorology centers, they come out, and what they do is this is the crew that comes out and identifies, was it straight line winds? Was it a tornado? If it was a tornado, how big a tornado was it? And this one turned out to be an EF2. So I received this Sunday morning from our on-staff meteorologist, Scotland Williams. She's one of our new EM personnel that we hired right at a year ago. So we were fortunate enough to pick up a meteorologist on staff, and Scotland does a fantastic job with predictions, modeling, and, you know, when we have questions, we go to her. Shore up or ground truth, what National Weather Center is saying, and where are they seeing these things, and what models are showing these things. So she had received this, and through her channel, because she's in a huge meteorology network channel, and she forwarded this on to us, and I said, wow, that just sums it up right there. It was an EF2, as we thought it was a tornado at Pensacola Beach. We weren't 100% certain that it was a tornado on the southwest side of Pensacola, but it shows that there was straight line winds associated with the storm development on the front end, and didn't show strong signs of a tornadic activity. But as it grew and went further to the south and to the east, you could see the development. Then it turned into a waterspout over the bay, and then hit Galvez and that area of Pensacola Beach. And then it was an EF2 at that moment. So they look at things like factors such as, you know, debris field, how far things were moved away, penetration of 2x4s in the siding of houses, wind is blown out, cars, and how you know how heavy some objects are, so you know what wind speed or where what size tornado that would have to be to move that. So that was interesting. I want to send that to you guys, to the board and everybody, to let them know that, yes, we did have a tornado. It was identified by these factors. And it talked about a dumpster being moved and
yes,
items being thrown everywhere. And those are the key things they look at to identify what size storm we had. Was it straight line or was it tornadic? So that's why I wanted to forward it to you guys, so you could see that, yeah, we did have a tornado hit us. So.
Yeah. Well, there was no doubt. It hit Galvez Court, and that's right next to Tristan Towers, where I have a condo. I happen to be out there between tenants, you know, doing some maintenance and some cleaning of the unit. And I was telling Wes, as we came on here, it just went from a rainstorm with some lightning to the palm trees on their side. And I'm like, what in the world is going on? You know, my sliding door, it's thick, like in a marine aquarium, and it was bowing in. I'm like, what in the world? Come to find out when I went like a dummy, when I went to open the sliding door to save my chairs before they all went flying, I felt like the pressure. Anyway, it all made sense after, I heard, and we had some damage in Tristan Towers too. We had a wall blowout, and significant issues in the parking lot, the gates, the fire department. I think the county fire department had to come and secure our gates because they couldn't open because they got bent. The frame got bent in the wind. So just appreciate, I just want to say on behalf of the citizens of Escambia County, Eric, your team, first responders, the sheriff's office, everyone. Thank you very much for what you guys did, what you do. We've all now seen the video of the deputy being swept under the, that's just amazing. They're just both very fortunate to be alive. Imagine if there was a log stuck in that pipe, it'd be a very different story. So just a crazy night. And hopefully we don't have anything like that anytime soon. Can you help us with that, Eric?
I'll do my best, but I would like to take this opportunity to brag on our staff here and just let the citizens know what all transpired that night and what all went into play, because, when these things happen, we just don't, it's just not off the cuff that we make these things happen. This is training, this is networking. And I got to say, I've gone to a lot of disasters, and I've seen other municipalities and counties and everybody interact, and it's like they've met for the first time during a disaster. And it just befuddles me that that happens. And we have a very robust response here in Escambia County. And I'll explain a little bit. So, we had the men and women of the fire department, Escambia Fire, EMS, our emergency management team, the Escambia County Sheriff's Office. Let me tell you something. When you pick up the phone and call any one of those people, ECAT, Public Works, it's a great feeling to know that if Travis was making calls at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the morning, and our directors and our outside agencies and our partners were picking up that phone and going, what do you need?
Yes,
we're en route. Sheriff's Office had the 2 high water vehicles. So we had a total, a little over 200 rescues that night. So while the rescues were going on in the floodwaters, we were picking people out of Patton Drive. That was 146 that night. Then we had Reef Center that we had to evacuate. ECAT fully there with their buses ready to go in the middle of the night to take them to Marie K. Young, one of our county buildings that we've identified. All these things have been pre-identified on. If we have to do this, then we do this. And our staff and our public safety staff and our county staff is very good at pivoting. So if this doesn't work, all right, here's plan B, here's plan C, here's plan D. They're very good at pivoting. So it was phenomenal down to the Red Cross. So, you know, I got to get a kudos to public safety staff to include our communications. They were answering over 100 phone calls an hour.
Wow.
For help. And everybody that we know that we got to that called us, we did get to them, not maybe immediately, but sometime through the night and prioritize who was most urgent. We got a crew to them. So during all the water rescues of the people flooding out in the streets, and then the two big facilities that we were doing water rescues on with the sheriff's office help with the high water vehicles and our boats, and then ECAT taking them to the Marie K. Young, we had four working structure fires in the midst of all that due to lightning strikes. So we had four actual structures on fire when we had our departments out there fighting fires, pulling people out of floodwaters. It just, when you think about the enormity of all that and everything going on, and you know, we didn't have, you know, Santa Rosa, they were impacted like we were, so they couldn't send us mutual aid. So we didn't give mutual aid from there. City was dealing with their own thing. So the county was actually doing it with all our community partners and making it happen. So it's amazing that all that went on. And like I said, it doesn't happen just because we snapped our fingers and everybody come together. It happened because we have those relationships.
Right. So important. You guys train, you coordinate, and you have good relationships, good rapport with all these folks. And so when the situation arrives, you know, these things happen and we were able to help the folks. Do we still have people at Marie Young still, or have we closed that down?
Good question. So working with the Forest Creek Department of Management, they've taken all their people out of the shelter. And then REAP Center, we work with Waterfront. Waterfront now houses all the REAP evacuees. So Marie K. Young, as of yesterday afternoon, was officially shut down as a shelter. So Red Cross has closed it down. Appreciate Red Cross stepping up to the plate, doing the sheltering for us and handling that. But yes, our shelter has shut down and everybody's transitioned to Waterfront. Thank you, Waterfront, for stepping up.
Yes.
And taking on all those families and children that was in there. And the anticipation, REAP did receive some water damage. They had a little bit of water in the building. I think a little bit more than a little. They have water in the building, but they should be back up and running by next weekend is what they anticipate. So they mucked it all out, ripped the sheetrock out. They're putting it all back. So by next weekend, they should be occupying that building again.
Okay, fantastic. Well, Eric, I tell you, you and your team and all the people that helped, that was an incredible response. And we are a great community. And, you know, I really am proud when I tell people about all the first responders and all the hard work that they do. And I read about, unfortunately, I couldn't make it the Saturday morning thing. I had to clean up some damage at my condo. Unfortunately, I couldn't make it out there. But tell us about the awards event. I know the Escambia County Fire Rescue had a big awards event, and I saw a little bit of it. Tell us about probably the most profound things from that day.
Well, so for the award ceremony, so there was company citations where companies have done something outstanding or gone above and beyond. So the several companies got rescue awards, courage awards. The individuals got courage awards for being in a situation and overcoming and putting themselves on the line. We had several people who have done that. So those guys received awards. And then we had promotions. So we had a promotion ceremony for our firefighters transitioning to a lieutenant, lieutenant now. Yeah. So that was great. Then we had our typical officer of the year, career and volunteer. And then we had our firefighter of the year, career and volunteer. So we recognized both companies, career and volunteer, for officer and firefighter of the year. It was a great ceremony. Everybody came out and supported our fire guys. Andrew McKay was the MC of it. So appreciate him coming out and doing that and taking time. But it was a great event to recognize our men and women in the fire service and what they do and how they go above and beyond. You know, it's a firefighter. You know, there's certain inherited dangers you're going to do, right? So it's part of the job, right? So we all, you just did your job. Well, sometimes you do go above and beyond your job. You take that extra risk or you take that extra step and gain a huge reward in doing it by saving a life or doing
something
that you typically wouldn't do in a certain situation. So we want to make sure those men and women are recognized for those things.
No, absolutely. And do you know, do we have that on my Scambia on the YouTube channel? Did we tape that so that folks could watch that?
That's a good question. I know Davis was there documenting, taking pictures. I don't know if we recorded it. I can find out.
Okay. Well, if so, yeah, because I would like to watch that. I feel bad I couldn't make it, but you know, the weekend happened and there was a lot of there was some damage that we had to take care of. So, right. Well, thank you for everything. Final thing before we go to Dr. Harper, and because I can't wait to ask a bunch of questions. We've got two fire stations in the works in District 1. Very, very important to me. One of them, I think the trusses have gone up, Wes. My understanding from talking to Rob Hogan is we're still on for early November opening for the Bradshaw McNair station, the former station 2 in Beulah. Is that correct? Oh, Wes, your microphone's off.
That is correct, Commissioner. You are right.
All right. And what's the status of the triangle, the Bermuda Triangle in
District? We're working this swap with the easement that they want in order for us to get the triangle. So we're neck deep into that. And I'll get you a better status, but we've been driving and communicating with them weekly to try to bring that to fruition.
Yeah, that's down in Paradise Beach area for the viewers and the folks that live down there. No, we had Station 20 down there. It was closed down. We had a lease. There was problems. It answered about one structure fire call a year. A decision was made by the then public safety director and the then county administrator to close that station. It's been a tremendous impact on the residents out there. And ever since then, we've been trying to get a different location. We are working with the U.S. Navy very near to Bronson Field area. On the other side of Bower Road is a very small piece of property. We've already done the engineering. We've purchased some of the equipment. We've got modular buildings. We're ready to go. We're waiting on the Navy. Hopefully, hopefully we get that thing moving because it will help the Navy as well. It will provide a first responder capability for Bronson where they have some recreational facilities. So we need to get that done. So Eric, are you speaking with Opelenik? Are you speaking with the captain? Who are we working with?
It's our real estate division that has been working through Opelenik.
Okay. All right.
I think there's been some discussion with some folks in Jacksonville as well.
Okay. All right. Well, we're standing by. We got money. We're ready to do that project too. So two fire stations on the way in District 1. Okay. Well, without further ado, Rick, thank you very much for your patience. And now you know exactly what's going on in the county.
Absolutely. It's fascinating to hear. It's a lot of good news this year.
It is. Well, Dr. Harper is just a fascinating guy. And we had a lunch in the NAOP group that I attended in my capacity as an employee of ESA South, not really as a county commissioner, but of course there's always a lot of tie-ins. And when you started giving that presentation, and the other gentleman gave a presentation that was equally as interesting about the banks and the banks, how they went under, you know, Silicon Valley, First Republic, and the others. But yours in particular had a lot of interesting stuff about our area and a lot of highlights. So I appreciate you coming on. And I guess the first question that I'd like to ask you is, and we'll start at the national level, kind of work from the macro down to the micro. But what's the state of this national economy with the inflation and the Fed interest rates? What's your assessment of it?
The national economy is pretty strong. We continue to get good job growth reports. The increase in non-farm payrolls every month continues to be very, very much in the positive space, 200,000, 300,000 net new jobs per year. And so that's pulling people into the labor market. That's what we want to see. We've now got labor force participation rates that are quite high. So from that perspective, the national economy is strong. The inflation picture is improving. Looking at the May 2023 inflation figures, the consumer price index, we're actually running at 4.1% inflation, which is a lot. It's more than we'd like to see, but it is well below the 9% that we were seeing a number of months ago. And so with inflation coming under control, the job market continuing to be strong, that means that hopefully the Fed will not have to have many more interest rates. They increase interest rates to make it more expensive to buy a home, to buy a car, in order to slow down the rate of purchases, in order to slow down demand out there in the economy, in order to slow down price growth. So the good news is that we are more or less on a path to a smooth landing, a glide path, so that we don't plunge into recession as the Fed raises interest rates. So overall, the national economy is good.
Okay, so that leads me into another question. So the Fed, they've had this series of rate hikes, and then I believe at their last meeting, they left it kind of unchanged, but they did kind of signal that maybe they weren't exactly done. Do you anticipate a series of quarter point hikes going forward?
That's what the market expects. Traders in New York, the bond prices reflect the idea that the Fed's going to have to continue. And that's what Chair Jay Powell said on behalf of the Fed, is that inflation continues to be higher than the 2% target that the Fed has, and which the European Central Bank also has a 2% inflation target. That's just enough inflation so that it's not a big influence on people's decisions. It's not especially painful, but it keeps us out of the risk of falling prices. Because if you think that that home price, that car price, any price in the economy is going to be lower next year, that would encourage you to wait until next year to buy that item. That's the risk of falling into a recession, lower economic growth, negative economic growth. And so the Fed's working hard to avoid that. So they're on a tightrope. And they don't want to raise interest rates to kill off jobs of carpenters, sheetrock hangers, roofers, people in mortgage origination, people in banking, all the jobs that are at risk from a slowdown in the real estate sector. So they don't want to raise interest rates so much as to hinder overall growth in the economy. But at the same time, they worry the other side of the tightrope is that if they leave interest rates too low, then we will see increased inflation as people go out there and continue to spend at a healthy clip. So right now we're in that kind of unusual feeling position of, is it a Goldilocks economy? If the economy is growing too fast, the Fed will step in. If it's growing too slow, then we'd need more growth. Right now, the economy is just right.
No, that's perfect. Yeah, the porridge is just right. Well, I mean, I certainly hope that it stays that way. But like a lot of folks, I'm concerned that we keep borrowing more money. And not to get too political, because both parties do it, right? I love the Republicans to say, oh, the Democrats are spending. But wait, when the Republicans had it, they did this exact same thing. The bottom line is I would like to see us get to a point where we do a balanced budget. You know, I'd love to see that. I just don't think either party has the self-discipline or control to do that, sadly. And I wish that they did. But with all that trillion, where are we at? $32 trillion in debt, plus the long-term unfunded liabilities of the social programs, the transfer programs. I mean, at some point, that bill is going to have to be paid, right, Rick?
Well, it does. We've started to pay it in a way that is a bit risky, which is that as the Fed creates more money supply. Remember when we were headed into the debt crisis?
I do.
Debt ceiling showdown about a month ago. There was talk of minting a new $1 trillion platinum coin. That would have been a way of monetizing our national debt, of taking $1 trillion of that debt and just turning it into excess U.S. dollars. That's a recipe for higher inflation over time. We don't want to go there. But you're absolutely right, Commissioner, that as we look at the long-term debt picture, the U.S. gross domestic product, the size of the economy, is running just over $20 trillion a year. And so when you have national debt that's greater than that at $32 trillion total, then that means that the interest expense to service that debt becomes large. Mm-hmm. And $32 trillion, if you're paying an average of, say, 1.5% to 2% back a couple of years ago, and the debt was only $25 trillion, then we had debt service expense, interest on stuff we've already purchased that was running at about $400 billion a year. In our enormous federal budget of $6 trillion a year, you can almost afford $400 billion in interest expense to service the nation's debt.
But boy, that's a high percentage. That's a high percentage of your budget paying interest, though.
Well, it is, but just think how high it's going to go now that interest rates are higher. So if the government has to pay 4%, 5% interest, and that's the effect of the Fed's action is to raise interest rates. If you have to pay 4% and there's $32 trillion of debt out there, then you're going to be paying, what is that? $1.2 trillion a year in interest expense. That's enormous on a $6 trillion federal budget. So I agree with you completely. There has to be a solution to the debt crisis. And of course, what economists will tell you is that, yes, you need to balance the budget, but you need to do it over the course of the business cycle. When the economy is in recession, that's when you should do deficit spending to put money in the hands of consumers who will spend it and pull you out of recession. But when the economy's going great and the economy's very healthy, that's when you should not be doing deficit spending because it just piles more spending and increases the pressure for inflation. So the answer is balance the budget over the course of the business cycle. Deficits during recessions and surpluses during economic expansions. That's how you balance the budget.
No, and I sure wish that either or both parties had the discipline to do that, but they don't. When the times are good, they spend more money. When they have a bad recession, we gotta spend more money.
Everybody wants a tax cut. Everybody wants their Social Security benefits to increase. And so those pressures are overwhelming for politicians. When you're running for office every 2 years, it's tough to say, oh, we've got to bite the bullet and we've got to take painful steps to bring the debt down.
That's just tough to do. And Dr. Harper, they're never going to do it. So let's talk about this slide. To me, this was the most profound slide, and we can see it up on the screen here that you presented. And I just thought this blew me away because, you know, Mobile's 50 miles away from where I live, go there from time to time, went there for New Year's. But it seems like a big city compared to Pensacola. You go to their downtown, they've got a couple skyscrapers. I mean, just big. But look at this. Explain what this slide means, because I think this is something that needs to be celebrated.
These two lines represent two metro areas. The blue line represents the Pensacola metro area, which is Escambia in Santa Rosa County. We've got about, 530,000 people living in our two-county metro area. The Mobile metro area, which is red line, historically has been larger in terms of population and in terms of job growth. This slide shows thousands of people employed. And so what's remarkable is if you look over to the left of the slide and down at the bottom, we start at January of 2000. Back in January of 2000, the Pensacola metro area had about 150,000 employees total, whereas Mobile had about 180,000 employees. But over time, fast growth, and you know, sometimes we hear that people will say that Pensacola is a slow growth area, but it's not a slow growth area. We grow 50% faster than the nation on average. People want to come to Florida to live. They want to come to Pensacola to live. We have a lot of inbound migration, particularly among seniors. Fastest growing population cohort for Pensacola over the coming 30 years is going to be ages 65 and over. But that creates job opportunities because seniors buy healthcare, meals away from home. They look kind of like tourists in the way that they spend money, really. So back to this slide, if you look at Mobile, it's been relatively stagnant in terms of job growth from 2000 to where we are in 2023. They've added 10,500 jobs, an increase of almost 6%. But if you look at Pensacola over that same period, starting from our point in January of 2000 of just over 150,000, today we are at 197,000 in the most recent statistics. We've grown 30% over that period.
Yeah. Dr. Harper, that's an incredible statistic. That's amazing. This is kind of funny. You'll get a kick out of this. So one of your former students is on the chat right now and said, "Hello, Dr. Harper. I took an economics class at Navy Federal with you a few years back. I still see supply and demand chains in my nightmares." Of course, I'm just kidding. That's funny. No, it's interesting stuff. And I'll tell you what, a lot of folks don't realize, you know, just Florida. I mean, just look at Florida. Like this slide just briefly. I mean, tell us about this.
It's astonishing. Of course, right there in 2020, if you can see the gray shaded lines on your screen, those are recessions, the vertical bars shaded in gray. Those are recessions for the US. We had the Great Recession from December of 2007 until June of 2009, a long and severe recession. Florida got hit hard because it was a housing recession. That blue line for Florida sloped down much more steeply than the red line for the US. So we got clobbered because it was a recession centered on housing. Florida has very fast housing growth because we've got so many new people moving to the state that you've got to have a large construction sector to build the homes to service those needs. And I see you flip to the inflation slides.
Let's talk about inflation.
So inflation, if you extended that blue line, the consumer price index, that was what we see here with the blue line being at 5% for the most recent month back when you and I were at that talk. Today, the most recent data show that it's come down from 5% down to 4.1%. So the trend is in the right direction for inflation. That means that the Fed can ease off a bit on the rate hikes. But as you say, markets are expecting probably two more 0.25% interest rate increases, but inflation is trending in the right direction. We can get that soft landing where we get back to regular growth, which for Florida is much faster than the nation, and for Pensacola is faster than the nation. If we can get there without a recession, that's what economists will call a soft landing, getting back to normal growth trends that are sustainable without worrying about either recession on the downside or inflation if we grow too fast. So the signs are good right now.
Okay. Well, I'm going to get to the slide that we talked about. I remember you talked about there's 356 large counties in the country. I'm going to go find that slide.
Well, it's not in a slide. The day that we had that talk, that press release from the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics had just come out that morning.
Okay.
And so we'll have to just talk about it. It was impressive. And the Bureau of Labor Statistics sorts communities by size and publishes statistics. And of the 356 largest metro area, actually largest counties, that was county specific data in the country, Escambia is one of them. And among those 356 counties, we ranked 22nd in the nation for growth in average weekly wages.
Now say that again, because that's incredible. We were number 22 out of the largest 356 counties in the nation. We're number 22. What does that put us in the top, 4%? So in that's wage growth.
6%,
6%, wow.
I mean, and so that's what we need to see. You know, Florida has never had trouble creating new jobs because people moving to the area, people wanting to come visit. We're now at 130 million people, tourists a year, visiting the state of Florida. You know, if we'd been talking 10 years ago, we would have, we're doing great. We're at 80 million. And so we've had extraordinary growth in the number of people that want to come to Florida, and realize that over the most recent period for which the U.S. Census Bureau has published data, Florida was the fastest growing state in the nation. We grew almost 2% in population in 1 year. And that's part of it's COVID. You know, those statistics are from during the COVID recession when people were fleeing large city centers, such particularly New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, our largest metro areas, and they were looking for, you know, more space and even a white picket fence. And they came to Florida overwhelmingly.
Well, I think a lot of what they were really trying to do was find a place that was open, right? A lot of those states had everything shut down. I went to California twice during the pandemic and it was ridiculous. I mean, restaurants were closed. I mean, yeah, you know, and at least in Florida, I think for a couple of months there till we, you know, in March, April, May of 2020, had things closed down while people were trying to figure things out. But, you know, to his credit, then the governor opened up the state and said, look, we're not going to hide in our houses. We're not going to hide. And I think that was a smart decision on balance, because when you look at the deaths from COVID and you look at the blue states had the higher death rates, even with the shutdowns, the masks, the double masks, the quintuple masks. I mean, they still had more deaths than we did here. I mean, it was a horrible pandemic, but the economic damage in some of those states, I think, is still ongoing, and I think it's going to continue. But in Florida, I think it helped us. So, but let's talk about housing, because housing is something that affects us all here locally. And you did talk about that during the presentation. And why is it that rents on Davis Highway and these old apartment complexes are through the roof right now? You're an economist, well, but why
again,
are the housing
prices? Of course, being an economist, I'm going to tell you it's supply and demand.
Right.
You know, when people moved to our state, as they did, the only metro areas that lost population, even briefly during the COVID recession, were Miami and Orlando. Orlando, because it is so focused on tourism services and face-to-face tourism services, did decrease as people curtailed their travel during COVID. But the other 20-some metro areas in Florida all grew. And since the COVID recession has waned, COVID has waned, the pandemic has waned, and the economy's recovered, Orlando and Miami are going great guns right now.
Oh, I bet.
Florida is booming. And when people are coming to your state, whether it's tourists looking for a place to rent, Airbnb has been strong in Florida, whereas it's decreased in many other areas of the nation. So when population grows, it puts pressure on the housing stock. And there's limited housing, and builders can't build it fast enough. They've had problems finding labor. Material prices are 50% higher than they were before the recession started. And so put those things together, and you've got enormous pressure on the limited housing supply that we had. Think of the peak of the housing boom that we had from 2003 to 2006.
Yes.
We now have 25% more population here in Florida than we did at the peak of that boom in 2006. But the number of building permits issued in a two-county Pensacola metro area this spring is still 10 to 15% lower than it was at the peak of the building boom back in 2006. And so when you put limited supply, scarcity of housing units into a market that's experiencing inbound migration from other states, that's a recipe for higher rents, for higher home prices, and that's exactly what we see. In fact, the most recent data on home prices show that over the past 4 months, housing prices in Pensacola, which had fallen in the second half of 2022, they are now rising again, so that home sale prices are now year over year. So in May of 2023, compared to May of 2022, housing prices are actually higher than they were a year ago. The good news is that increase is only in the single digits, luckily, because homes have just become unaffordable. And so one of the risks that we face is that higher housing prices and inability of the home building sector to respond adequately with more labor and due to higher materials prices, we're still seeing housing shortages across the state of Florida, and that's true in Pensacola.
Yeah, and you just hit it, housing shortages. One of the things that we do in this line of work as a county commissioner is we approve zonings for people to build apartments and houses, and every time we go to approve something, there, without fail, there's 50, 60, 80, 100 people with their hair on fire saying, no more building. We can't have any more building. Shut it down. Moratorium. But then they wonder why their kids are paying $1,700 a month for a dumpy old apartment on Davis. Or how come I can't afford a house? Well, I'm glad I have an economist here to explain it to them. It's supply and demand, right, Rick? I mean, come on.
Absolutely it is.
So we're not supposed to build anymore. So if we don't build anymore, let me ask you this. And I'm just, you know, playing devil's advocate a little bit. You know, I say it all facetiously. I'm not making fun of anyone. I understand people are passionate. I understand their concerns about infrastructure, and we're building a lot of infrastructure. It's hard to keep up with such inbound migration as you described. But If we said, yes, okay, we're going to countenance what the mob wants. We're never going to build another apartment. We're not going to approve any more subdivisions. We're going to say, time out. No. First, we'd be sued, Bert Harris. But if we, in some magic universe, were able to do that, tell the folks what happens to the prices then.
Well, when you constrain housing supply, like you're discussing in that hypothetical, what you'll have is a growing number of people pressing up against an unchanged supply of housing that squeezes home prices higher. They explode higher. And when that happens, that's when our children won't be able to afford to come home after college or stay here after college. They'll have to leave for areas which have more expansive policy and better real estate prices. So we need, obviously you can't control everything that goes on in all parts of the county, but certainly in the city, we need infill development so that we can let people enjoy the amenities of our beautiful downtown area. We need to see more housing supply in that's perhaps a bit further work commute for people so that they're spread throughout the county. That will let people enjoy the benefits of living in Florida, the weather, the attitudes, the low tax environment. People are looking for that. And it's just no accident that growth in Florida exceeded that of any other state at 1.9% per year. It's because people are voting with their feet.
Yes.
They're going where they want to live. But we have to be careful to do everything that we can to expand the ability of private sector builders to put houses on the market to meet the needs of this population. Otherwise, we'll see continued increases in prices. Eventually, that'll become self-limiting because when you see home prices go higher, people have to think twice about making that decision to come here. And so I personally think as an economist, and someone that lives here, I think the problems of growth are better than the problems of stagnation.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Yes, we do need to let the market play its role of increasing housing availability for Pensacolians.
No, you're 100% spot on, and we've done that in District 1. But I do understand the frustration because, unfortunately, we have a building code that really is slanted in the favor of the developers, the builders. It's very difficult to move the needle on that. I've tried multiple times to bring concurrency back. We had concurrency, which would have allowed us to charge if they want to build very close to a overcrowded school, for instance, or an area that didn't have enough provision of public services. We had concurrency for many years in the state. Rick Scott pulled it out during the recession. Speaking of recessions, he pulled it out. The county put it in the land development code, but then they pulled it out in 2013. And it's one of those things, the canary leaves the cage. You're never going to put it back in there. The minute you even talk about it, I brought it a couple times, it'll never happen. Sadly, but I brought it, concurrency, mobility fees, Christine Fanchi, when she was here, we brought it. There's just no appetite. So folks, they're frustrated, but we do have that one ace in the hole. We do have the one penny, local option sales tax, which we do spend. We deploy all that money. Primarily the lion's share of it goes to infrastructure. We do some economic development with it. And that's an area I'm really glad you're here, Dr. Harper, because there are people in the community, and I'm not going to name them and shame them, but there's not an insignificant number. It's a small number, but it's not insignificant, that think that any kind of economic development activity, any kind of government E-date, any kind of government incentive for a company like Navy Federal, Circulogene, Pegasus Labs, any of these others that we're bringing in, they think that that's not a function that government should do. Just build sidewalks and streets and they'll come. But what's your thoughts on economic development? Seeing that chart, seeing how Pensacola has blown up over the last 30 years over Mobile.
You do have to have good streets, as people say, and you have to have good schools. Yes. And this is a challenge for us. The pattern of growth is such that historically, people would move next door to Santa Rosa County as their income rose, looking for that half acre lot or quarter acre lot with a picket fence, with four bedrooms and a good school system. That's a challenge that Escambia faces. We have intergenerational poverty, but the way to eliminate to alleviate intergenerational poverty is to provide better jobs. And those better jobs come from companies that look at our area and say, geez, you've got enough labor force and you've got training programs, you've got career and technical education that would mean that I could get the 1,500 new workers I need or the 100 workers that I need. Or if you look at Navy Federal, the 10,000 workers
right.
that I need in order to be successful. So you have to strike the balance. Property taxes need to be low and reasonable, which Florida always has. We have we're a lower tax burden state across the 67 counties than other states in the union, but we've got to make sure that those property taxes are sufficient to finance the infrastructure that we need. Look at our neighbors, Santa Rosa, who are experiencing great growth. You know, they're as a metro area, well, gosh, over half the people who get up and go to work every day in Santa Rosa County come to Escambia for their job.
Yep.
But that means that back in Santa Rosa, with a population that's among the fastest growing in the state that's the fastest growing, that means that they're looking for funding to finance new wastewater treatment facilities, which they badly need. But the risk is if you keep property taxes too low, we're lucky we have, as you say, the penny for progress to be devoted to infrastructure, because when you don't have that, roads become inadequate to service the needs of the population, wastewater, sidewalks, streets, everything that government provides. So the balance is to be struck. And I think Escambia is doing a good job of that.
Thank you. Well, final thing, man, it's amazing how quick an hour goes, but this is such, to me, I should have, man, I love economics. It's such a fascinating topic. But one question came from here. I just want the cost of groceries to come down. Fixed income folks are struggling. Okay, so let's talk about commodities like eggs. We saw them go way up and now they're way down. I went and bought an 18 pack for like $1.97. They were like $8 at Walmart. Now they're back down. Let's talk about commodities and pricing and the economics of that, Rick.
Yeah, and the COVID pandemic really exposed some of the challenges in the supply chain for us. And that's true with eggs. And the biggest cause of the egg price increase was actually avian flu, bird flu, that they had to put down tens of millions of chickens because of the risk of the spread of that disease. And so that drove egg prices up. And now they're back down because producers respond to market incentives. When the price of eggs goes through the roof, what you do is you make sure your hen house is full and you're bringing them to market. Right. And so it's the natural course of the marketplace. COVID puts a challenge in that framework. Who would have thought that we'd run out of toilet paper and paper towels? But indeed, businesses design their factories, whether it's an egg farming operation or whether it's a paper towel manufacturing operation, they want them to run at peak efficiency, which means that when all of a sudden everybody's wiping down every counter in their house multiple times a day with paper towels, that means you need 50% more paper towels and the factories just aren't there to do it. So in a sense, it's a fragile ecosystem, but it does respond strongly to incentives out there in the marketplace. So hopefully we're going to have a period of relative price stability here. Inflation is less than half of what it was during the peak. We're now at 4.1%, way down from 9%. We've still got a ways to go until the Fed is comfortable at 2-3%.
Yep. And we're not Argentina yet, where it's 100% and it's just like stabilized at 100%. I don't know how they do that down there, but I know Zimbabwe had the problem back in the day. Iceland's had those challenges in the past. Mexico had they had to rebalance their currency. I just don't want
Israel had that problem. Argentina was the poster child.
Yeah. Okay. Final question, because now we're out of time. But two things. You're the economic advisor for Triumph Gulf Coast, $1.5 billion from the oil spill. How much of that money have we put on the street? And how much of that is really contributing to this red hot economy locally, in your opinion?
Well, we've encumbered over $400 million out of the $1.5. Judge Barbier allowed BP to pay of the $19 billion settlement, of which our 1.5 is part. Judge Barbier in New Orleans allowed BP to pay that out over a period of years. So Triumph funding is coming in, and over time at a rate of about 80 million year, 80 million per year to Triumph. And we have spent the majority of those, we've encumbered the majority of those funds. They haven't gone out the door because a lot of the infrastructure projects that we funded are multi-year in nature. For example, the single largest project that Triumph has funded is $66 million towards hangars 2, 3, and 4 at Pensacola. Yes. And that money has not yet gone out the door, even though it's been encumbered, because they're just finishing Hangar 2. A lot of that money came from the U.S. Economic Development Administration. The Triumph money goes largely to Hangars 3, 4, and the admin building. Mm-hmm. And so we've encumbered well over half of the dollars that are available for projects across the 8 westernmost coastal counties. That's Wakulla, Franklin, Gulf, and then Bay, where Panama City is, Walton, Okaloosa, Santa Rosa, and Escambia are the places where we can spend money on public infrastructure. And so we've still got a ways to go, because unless the legislature does something to us, we'll have $80 million a year coming in until 2033 to be spent.
Yeah, and that's I guess that's kind of surprising to me. I thought that money was in the bank, but I mean, I guess it makes sense that it's coming in yearly, but that's, I guess that's kind of interesting to me. Final question, and Rick and Eric and Wes, thank you very much for your time this morning, your patience. I love doing these things. Just fascinating, great information. And, but final question, Rick, 5 years looking forward to Escambia County, Pensacola, give me your outlook, your prediction. If you could look into a crystal ball with your knowledge and your finger is on the pulse, what's the next 5 years look like in Pensacola, Escambia County?
You know, I think the next 5 years will be good. What we've seen is Pensacola and Escambia County, but also the two county metro area, has kind of achieved critical mass. I expect to see continued expansion as people seek to move here because it's one of the more affordable parts of Florida where they can enjoy a Florida lifestyle. As you mentioned, we're seeing a lot of people who move here because of the commitment to an open economy.
Right.
While people are still wearing masks until this day in California, they're not in Florida. And it's a lifestyle that a lot of people appreciate. And so we've got to meet the basic challenges of safe streets, great schools in order to keep them coming here. We have a statewide challenge that with construction costs up 50%, that means that it's 50% more expensive to repair that home that's been damaged. Insurance rates are high. I think much of our challenge is at the state level. We've got to find ways to eliminate nuisance lawsuits and unfair lawsuits in the insurance market. And as long as we do that, keep our taxes at a reasonable rate and have safe streets and good schools, will be a great place for people to live and call home, and will attract people that will fill the new high-wage jobs of tomorrow. So I think the future is bright for our area.
So within the next 5 years, no recession locally, you don't think?
No, we will not have a recession locally. I think that the national economy will have a recession. Hopefully it will be a mild recession, but because of Florida and Escambia and Santa Rosa counties, more rapid growth rate relative to the nation, I don't think that we will slip into negative GDP territory in the region.
God, I hope you're right. I hope you're right. Dr. Harper, thank you, sir, for your time this morning. Thank you for what you do for Triumph, and it really benefits the citizens. And these numbers that we see over time really illustrate that. Our wage growth illustrates that. Our population growth illustrates that. We're doing it all right. We could do better on some things, but I just appreciate your time and what you do. Of course, I appreciate Wes and Eric and what those guys do. Appreciate y'all being here today, and thank you for your time today. And we'll be here next month with a coffee with the commissioner. And I just before we sign off, I want to point out one thing. Our office, District 1, is going to be changing. My long-term aide and my good friend, she's like a sister to me, Debbie Kenny, is going to be retiring. And so I'm excited to announce I've got a brand new person going to be working with me. We're going to be working side by side, arm in arm, getting things done for our citizens. Jesse Casey has started to work here in our office, and he's a good guy. A lot of people know him in District 1. He's going to be my eyes and ears out in the field, helping me get a lot of things done in District 1. So I want to welcome him. He'll be at the next meeting, and we'll introduce him and bring him aboard. So we're happy. And then next month on our Coffee with the Commissioner, I'm going to ask the guys from Perdido that are looking to incorporate. We're going to have them on the coffee, and we're going to ask them a lot of questions. And we're going to, they've got a survey out. And if you look later this week on my blog, you're going to see my answers to their survey. They're working to incorporate a large portion of the western part of Escambia County into a city. So I've taken a neutral position on that. I don't own property there. It is a part of District 1. However, I believe it's a decision that needs to be made by those property owners. But we're going to see if we can get the organizers on next month's coffee. So stay tuned for that. And I hope everyone has a great rest of the week. We'll see you next month.